Good evening. Welcome to a 48-hour marathon here at the AA. As you probably know, tomorrow and Sunday, we have a major international conference on psychoanalysis and space, and a number of speakers from the States, Europe, from all over the world, among them Tony Vidler, Marcy, here in the back, Parvin Adams, Sylvia Levin, Mark Wigley, and others. I hope that you'll be able to join us for that. As you also know, I'd like to say welcome to all the people who are watching from different parts of the world on the internet. This is the first live broadcast from the AA on the net. And for those of you who happen to have WAP phones, it's also being broadcast on the on WAP phones. So I'd like to welcome everybody who's watching us outside of this building. During the last 5 years, Rem has lectured here at least once a year, and he has managed every single time to bring new ideas, new provocations, and new inspirations to the school. During this time, he's been totally supportive of the school, and for that, I thank him. I think when we talk about practice and education, many people think about obviously conventional versions of practice. And it's very important that I think over the last, I don't know how many years it is that Rem has been in practice, he has constantly been able to rethink his relationship to his practice, to systematically renew the ideas of his own connection to the work, which is systematically intertwined with his research, writing, and teaching. And it's really this reinvention that I think has been also such an important part of the kind of productive work that has come out of the office, which has had much more of a research-based approach. Much of the work has been arguing or somehow based on a reluctance of engaging with various forms of idealization, I think. And in a way, it's been incredible that he has spent so much time on developing what one might term a kind of fantastic pragmatism, one that is so much based on the uncertainties, the unexpected, the unplanned conditions of the everyday, and really developing something that is at the height of the possibilities of the imagination, but nevertheless doesn't lose touch with the everyday circumstances and with the given. Recently, of course, he's been involved with many international projects and research works, from Lagos to the work for Prada to Toronto, which he has won recently as a large-scale urban competition. But I think more importantly, he has also brought together many of the researches and ideas in a new practice that I'm sure he's going to tell us about, which is the mirror image of OMA, AMO, a kind of virtual practice that focuses on the relationship between virtualities and actualities. Would you please welcome this year's Pritzker Prize winner, Rem Koolhaas.
Thank you. Can we have all the lights out? Thank you, Martin. Ever since our office inadvertently discovered that by putting the major currencies that are now important in the world in a sequence, the yen, the euro, and the dollar, that they spelled the word yes, we have been embarked on a, I hesitate to say systematic, but on an intense operation that is trying to do two things. First of all, to investigate which new potentials are embedded in globalization, because for me, the yes stands for a new conceptual space for all our cultures, in which architecture also has to manifest itself. And we all know that globalization has many different aspects, some of them extremely onerous and disturbing, others deeply exhilarating and stimulating. And for us, the past almost 10 years or 5 years were specifically dedicated in defining these potentials. It has given us a kind of puzzling, to me sometimes, reputation for being uncritical, but at the same time, it has increasingly enabled us to do work that is very pertinent or that is directly the result of globalization in two ways. Not only are we getting a new kind of client base that in itself manifests the condition of globalization, but I think that many of the work and projects we are doing now could not be done unless our office itself were not to some extent a mirror image of globalization, and unless it had the kind of exact proportion of different cultures and nationalities that it currently has. I've always suggested that architecture is in itself is, if it is executed on its own and in as a kind of singular pursuit, is a debilitating profession. It is debilitating because it is so complex and exhausting that it inevitably leads to a kind of position of dead end, because you can only produce, only create, and after a while there is nothing left to look at the world with. For that reason, we have systematically incorporated also in the past 5 years, together with this exploration of globalization, a research program that was connected, that is connected to Harvard. And increasingly, the work in the office and the research in Harvard are becoming kind of parallel tracks and benefit, creating a mutual benefit for each other. The research for Harvard was ostensibly looking at the city. The project is called Project on the City. And the underlying thesis is that one of the main and so far not universally recognized aspects of globalization is that it has declared the urban condition itself pervasive, and that suddenly we find ourselves in a situation where the city is ubiquitous, where everything is city, and where a number of contrasts, for instance, between city and its other, or city and countryside, or city and landscape, are no longer in operation. So part of the research in Harvard has been trying to define and trying to investigate the consequences of that merger, of the triumph of the urban. What is perhaps important to say is that although I usually present the results with a certain confidence and usually adopt a tone of relentless optimism, that of course some of the conclusions are deeply shocking, and certainly also the conclusions are not always welcome. Where, for instance, in the research in the Pearl River Delta in China, the incredible growth of the Pearl River Delta, which is on its way from a current population of 12 million to a future population of 20 million in 2020, and therefore creating amazing urban conditions like this one, which marries in a very small physical space. I don't think the distance between the rice fields here and the major intersection there is more than 400 meters. Contrasts that could not be imagined kind of in a single traditional urban condition. So there is in itself the proof of two things: that the urban condition has become pervasive, but in becoming pervasive, it has also become new or renewed itself. Because what we see here is actually an amazing image of the final topology, the skyscraper, there's almost only high rise, implanted in a field that is only very incompletely urban in the traditional sense of the word. But where this research was in itself exhilarating, although it and was exhilarating partly because of the openness with which forces that were much more latent here or much more invisible here or in America was actually not only revealed but actually lived as part of a visible thrill, where the creation of city in itself has become an incredibly potent emotion, and where the corresponding destruction is an equally potent emotion, probably giving to the same extent pleasure. And that is something that we have to somehow think about. But where the China project was in itself, for me, almost unambiguous in terms of its the excitement of its discoveries. The shopping book, which will be published, by the way, with the China book in September, is a much more ambiguous condition, and it is exciting for me to show today, let's say, my melancholy pessimistic side, or to forward it in the context of shopping, because the shopping book has had a very strong effect on our own architecture, as a kind of dire warning. So I won't tell you the main ingredients of the shopping book, but only identify a streak that runs through it and that is defining the impact of this condition on the status of architecture. The key diagram or the key calculation of the shopping book is to this one, which has calculated for every inhabitant of the world the number of square feet or square meters of shopping he or she has to support. We all know that certain civilizations are more blessed with shopping than others. And in the civilizations that are extremely engaged with shopping, the average citizen has sometimes to support some 30 square meter of shopping as a kind of lifelong burden, almost a kind of involuntary second house, which in itself, of course, is never revealed as a burden or never really openly spoken of as a burden, but it is a very strong form of engagement, involuntary engagement. But for me, the shopping book has more than ever kind of clarified is the incredible absurdity of architectural history writing, and particularly how architectural history writing is still emphatically the prisoner of the intimate mythology of architecture, which intimately is about material conditions, intimately about space and form, and is supposed to offer comfort and all of the material virtues. It is amazing that, for instance, the cluster of inventions that I've kind of spoken, that I've assembled here, which are those inventions which kind of finally made shopping as we know it possible, that almost none of them plays a major role in any formal architectural thinking, even though clearly they have a kind of tremendous influence and a bigger influence than those items or those subjects that are usually treated by architectural theory in terms of defining our world. And I just have to talk about the escalator. There is no book on the escalator. There is no history of the escalator. There's simply nothing about the escalator. And yet we know that without the escalator, our life would be utterly different and actually literally unthinkable. And also our architecture would also be non-existent. So that is just a small example of the kind of inherent and strict and continuing and ongoing weakness of architectural thinking in terms of its denial and its repressions of not only of technology, but of a series of inventions that are antithetical or potentially eroding the values of architecture. You can only look at architectural theory, even some of the most advanced in architectural history, even some of its most daring, as finally being a kind of defensive armature around the core values of architecture, and I think that very few have been able to escape. We still look at the diagrams of Le Corbusier and a diagram like this one, which is perhaps a very precise diagram of what in which culture we operate, not only but also in what field we operate, namely the field of multiplying floor space, usually for and increasingly for commercial reasons only. Something, a truth like that is effortlessly erased from the consciousness of architecture. And sorry to be so pedantic about it, but it is and remains astonishing that even today these kind of conclusions, these phenomena are not incorporated or in a to be rewritten history. I mentioned the triumph of shopping not only to as a kind of cynical interest or a kind of punishing to tell a punishing for architecture alternative story, but simply to show how a domain that we have never taken seriously has irrevocably infiltrated in every cell of our being and every cell of our architecture, and is now associated with almost any other program that we know known to men, whether it is the most serious infrastructure like airports, whether it is religious buildings like churches, whether it is educational establishments, cultural establishments. Everywhere shopping is an increasingly pervasive and increasingly large scale part of the presence, and an increasingly inevitable part of its kind of financial, critical part of its financial well-being. This is the Barcelona Pavilion, partly converted in a shopping center, and for me, this is kind of a little emblematic condition for the deep unconsciousness of architecture, because when Nice Barcelona Pavilion was destroyed, it remained a pure myth of a useless building. Its fans, in quotes, reconstructed it, and of course, in tarnished the myth inevitably, because the myth could only be sustained by commercial activity. So, and I would say that the fans stand for architecture. In the name of architecture, something was resurrected, and in the resurrection, its value was finally depleted and ridiculed. Here we see the kind of current condition of architecture, and somehow we all have glasses that look at the gray, and we have a profession that talks about the gray, but if we circulate and live and exist in the real world, paradoxically, what we see most is green in front of our eyes, and instead of the kind of rigor, orthogonality, and kind of large scale of the megastructure that you see there, we all know that the kind of basic event in architecture today is something that takes place perhaps at a distance of a meter at the most, and that increasingly the event of architecture is encroaching on us and coming closer and closer. We also know that the scale of architecture gets larger and larger. It is very often already almost impossible to say where a building begins and ends, and that in itself has a series of kind of fundamental repercussions. One of them, the most important one perhaps, and the most one leading to a condition of almost permanent apology around architecture, that no part of a single building lives in an exactly synchronized condition anymore, that certain parts are alive while other parts are dying, certain parts are healthy and energetic, and other parts are gangrenous. So that we, instead of buildings on the whole having a kind of single condition or a single index of their health, are increasingly becoming kind of ambiguous in terms of which part of it work and which parts of it don't work. And usually those parts that don't work rot for a certain time and then are converted into a new entity which may or may not work or rot, and which is usually designed or conceived virtually independently of the will of the architect. This is a typical image of the world today. It's an airport, and we see in front of it those who consume space, those who consume architecture for whom the architecture is intended, and behind a provisional screen of wood and sheetrock, we see those who produce space. And currently, the intensity of consumption is so intense that it has to be met by an equally intense and permanent quality of production, because without a continuous regeneration, also called conversion or rehabilitation, and in itself a significant word to be introduced in architecture, without a permanent rehabilitation, in America called upgrade, without a permanent upgrade, it doesn't work anymore. These are now the current materials of architecture, and this I don't say with any kind of pessimism, because I think the materials are great. It is only our unwillingness to confront their consequences which is bizarre. But of course, this kind of architecture is again an architecture that is never even theorized. There have been intermittent efforts. It's a close-up of a building in Las Vegas, and perhaps the last kind of serious moment of theorizing this kind of condition was Venturi's 72 learning from Las Vegas. But paradoxically, the lesson of Venturi not only went lost, but was ultimately denied by the huge physical scale and reality of Las Vegas. Anyway, it is for me completely inevitable that in this kind of mode of production and also in this kind of condition, this kind of architecture emerges, and it is only said that the connection between the two is not not mentioned, and that in our almost inevitable and compelling need to discover quality and masterpieces, the Guggenheim, which happens to be a masterpiece, is always analyzed as masterpiece or analyzed, described as masterpiece, but not as an outcome of a particular tendency or condition. In order to describe the condition of architecture now, I've written a text which is called Junk Space. And what it really is trying to do is to understand what architecture is today. And what we have is a kind of very paradoxical combination of architecture itself, which becomes more and more popular. The intensity of architecture is increasing almost daily. And also its claim to symbolism is almost uncontrollable. And its monumentality and complexity is also increasing beyond anything that has existed in history before. And yet, I challenge anyone looking at this particular image to inventorize the 400 different ingredients that are present in this image, but only 400 is, of course, a multiple, probably by 40 of the ingredients that are present in typical architecture, but even to remember a single piece of it. More than second. So one of the kind of strong effects of this research in Harvard has been a realization of the vulnerability of architecture and of its kind of really right now fundamental implausibility. It is almost an unbelievable profession that clings on with with its fingers on kind of huge abyss which has never been plumbed. That vulnerability, I think, has had the double effect on our work. On the one hand, kind of vindication that a sheer love of architecture is perhaps not the most fruitful drive for an architect, and that actual skepticism of architecture and at least enables us to assume a more critical position. But also, it has forced us to adopt new ways of thinking about architecture, but also new ways of making architecture manifest. This is a kind of horrendously classical representation of architecture. It's the headquarter for universal buildings. And except for a room like this, it is a completely meaningless form of representing architecture, in the sense that the real operation that was going on in this particular case was how to make a headquarter building for a company that was in sheer process of reinventing itself or inventing itself, and that consisted of a very irrational amalgamation of a liquor business married to a movie business that bought at the last moment also a music business, and that thought that this amalgamation that had to be represented by the architecture could then be broadcast, so to speak, on internet to form a kind of new entity. It's a long, year-long operation, and the outcome is not sure, but one thing that is certain is that this current constellation is utterly unstable, and that therefore it is not a picture of a program that is kind of recognizable and final, but on the contrary, it needs to represent a condition which is fundamentally unstable. We began to think that in order to communicate with the company, we needed not to represent it in architectural means. You see the kind of shadows of architecture kind of really behind these icons, and that it was more important to discuss the performance, because the performance of the building could still be maybe a viable discussion, and therefore suggested that the building needed four towers, one for ideas, one for circulation, one for community, and one for money, for management. And in the end, perhaps the building was best described as a kind of urban condition, with all its mutability and all its openness to any interpretation and change, than as a kind of physical building. And therefore, when we started to represent it in this way, even the client became kind of extremely enthused about its potential. In the same way, the kind of classical architectural device of the collage had to be abandoned when we conceived how the airport of Schiphol in Amsterdam could be taken off the land and be placed on a new island in the North Sea, an island dedicated entirely to traffic circulation and to the kinetic elite, those who need to move. But there again, the language of architecture was terribly old-fashioned, and only when we kind of represented it in pure conceptual combination and diagrams did it kind of resonate in the world of politics. Now, a number of projects that we're doing right now, of course, are projects that are on the cusp, that have one leg in the domain of globalization or in the world of globalization, and that are still also very classical entities, and perhaps none of those is more schizophrenic in a certain way, or having a foot in both camps, than the project we did, we are doing in Seattle for the Public Library. Seattle in itself, in its location, a complete core of a new way of thinking about substance, and the library, perhaps one of the most traditional ways of expressing cultural values in form. This image is an image we used to show to librarians what their self-image was, a building that does good in an unambiguous way, and that is open to the public in a very traditional way, and that therefore represents defensible moral values. But it is its earnestness, of course, addressing a public realm, that it has become completely transformed and that is unrecognizable and that simply doesn't register those signs of earnestness that still cling and define architecture to the extent that it does. So therefore, the obligation of a new building and a new library was to somehow temper or modernize that kind of moralism and somehow find a relationship to this iteration of the public realm or its implication. Now, one of the interesting things about the library is that, in effect, the library has become kind of modernized already for a long time, but that modernization is never being acknowledged. The library already for a very long time doesn't exist of books only. There is an infinite world of new media that has been kind of connected to it. In the same way, the problem of the library is already for a long time, not kind of simply a library, but there's an infinite number of additional social programs, fundraising programs, art programs, etc. They all have encroached on the mother definition of the library without the definition ever being kind of radically asserted. What is interesting is that the growth of libraries has simply so far always implied the multiplication of books to the point that in the end, almost like a caricature, the books push out the users of the library, and then the only thing you can do is start again. But of course we are kind of right now in a curious and exciting moment that the books can be kind of reproduced in miniature and that the information contained can also be miniaturized. So it could be a moment that actually the dictatorship or the dedication to the book no longer has to lead to a condition where a library accommodates the book in the end at its own expense. So what we felt was most important in this diagram, which is the program, blue is everything dedicated to books, to contain the books and to dedicate a particular area to them beyond which they would not go or grow, so that the rest of the program would be available for other media, but also for an articulation of the role of books as only one of different forms of media. And then we looked kind of more systematically at the program and simplified the components or inventorized the components and discovered that in this final band that there is a number of elements that are relatively knowable and certain. For instance, the building will have parking, the building will have books, the building will have an office component, and that there is a number of other elements, usually the public activities, that are much less described and circumscribed and that need much more than these elements to have the room to maneuver or to evolve. So there is a reading area, but God knows what reading will be. There is cataloging kind of system, but the catalog itself will no longer be the major vehicle of that kind of transaction. So we call it the mixing chamber. There will be some kind of reception, but it will not have the kind of moralism implied in libraries. So it's called the living room. And there will be children's department, as ever, to cultivate new. So in that sense, the diagram became a number of certainties layered with a number of kind of more uncertain things. The certainties were designed as platforms, as kind of boxes, that thanks to the kind of activities over our float. The spaces in between that were kind of in themselves much more irregular because they were simply generated by connecting the points of the different boxes became the kind of more open-ended spaces, more open-ended and evolutionary elements in the thing. So here you see the model on its way to becoming a building. The solid parts are the elements where we were certain, more or less certain what would happen, and also the rate of consumption, the rate in which it would be eaten. And spaces in between are the much more open and mutable conditions, living room, mixing chamber. Information is seen almost as a trading floor, the books in the reading room. What is very important and increasingly important is that the same diagram then also becomes the key to the portal of the library and becomes a way in which there is now an analogous condition, and this is something that we're working on now, that a website is not an extraneous element, either an afterthought or a dominating feat, but that the website, the architecture of the website and architecture of the building have a kind of correspondence and actually can be developed in a kind of mutually reinforcing manner. I think it makes the diagrammatic quality of the building stronger also, and I think that for a long time we may be in the age of the diagram, the millennium of the diagram. Here you see the structural system in its pure form, where, and it's also the surfacing system, where the boxes and those spaces are clad kind of in a single skin that is both the structure of the building, and if you see the kind of shadows that are there, also the kind of filter with which the relationship between inside and outside is negotiated in the building. The building is, Seattle is a very generic city. The downtown of Seattle is kind of infinitely gray, and so the forms of the boxes are slightly contextual in the sense that they address the few features that are there. There's a volcano, a mountain, and the water, and basically the different public spaces have views of those elements. This is an Arab diagram that shows that the system could be modified by simply eliminating part of the structure which are redundant or unnecessary, so that it looks at first sight like a very regular kind of net around the building in itself will have kind of perforations of larger scale. There are also elements where the net didn't work and isn't strong enough, then there will be kind of simply huge brutal concrete members that create irregular moments in it. So this is the current situation, a weaving instead of a structure, a weaving of I-beams, tubular elements, and concrete moments when they're inevitable. Here we look down on the living rooms, so on the lowest part. Here we are in the kind of trading floor, the catalog situation, which of course uses all the internet, but also all the other, a series of other technological devices that we're developing, where we're trying to do something similar to Prada, to find a new status for the technological, where it is not something that becomes demonstrative, but is. What is very important, and maybe the key to the whole thing, that in traditional libraries there is a kind of incredibly unappealing and deeply old-fashioned kind of subdivision of categories. The categories are, to anyone who is not a librarian, are almost strictly meaningless, like humanities is one of those utterly debased terms, and usually people sit behind a brownish desk. With the title Humanities. What we wanted to abandon the kind of corresponding obligation in almost every architectural iteration of the library of subdivision according to those categories, and instead propose the Dewey run, the kind of library system, to be present in the building as a kind of single spiral, organized in a single large box, in such a way that the circulation in the library kind of ultimately exposes you to all the books, and that therefore the kind of browsing also has a physical corollary, and that the point of a library, that the juxtaposition of all books to all other books, is made literally true in here. This is the reading room with a view of the mountains. And here a number of images of the library, both as we felt it was very important, although the building is fairly diagrammatic. The minor shifting of the different blocks and the different sizes of the blocks create a silhouette that is every time very different, and that was an important representation of a cultural element right now in Seattle. Here you see the building in its context of the city. The last architectural project I want to show is not only an architectural project, but actually part of a campaign. And it is a campaign that we have been involved in since the summer, when Patrizio Bertelli and Miuccia Prada came and proposed to us the following dilemma. The last 2 years, they had opened 200 stores. These are the stores. And they had achieved the final point, what the Prada store could be. And they felt that for a number of new and ongoing operations in Los Angeles, New York, San Francisco, and Tokyo, it was important to reinvent the store beyond what is now the well-known and classical and emblematic identity of Prada, the smooth, utterly comfortable, precise green interior of the stores. And they wanted to us to help or work on looking what, how they could be reinvented. We started by and this came at the end, and therefore in a kind of very smooth, but painfully, almost painfully smooth transition with the shopping book. I mean, it was a continuation, but almost a breathless one, that almost didn't allow time for kind of really thinking about whether it was a good idea. So we started by developing a Prada Atlas, that enabled us and them to see, you know, what was currently the nature of the operation and why, to try to find some patterns behind it. These are the Prada stores in the world related to centers of population. So there's still a lot of future Prada. These are the Prada stores in kind of relation to the size of national economies. This is the kind of diagram where a weak economy shrivels and a strong economy inflates. And here you see that, of course, the Prada stores have a tendency to gravitate to the inflated economies. This was interesting because these are Prada stores in relation to climate. At first sight, kind of redundant drawing, but until you think that most of the stores are in the moderate climate, and the moderate climate is of course the only climate that forces you to have two different collections in a year. And there's one exception, which is the Southeast Asia, where air conditioning itself introduces the experience of fall and winter. The way we read the implication and potential of these stores was important to avoid some of the more kind of classical ways of branding. Branding, to the extent that this is kind of American idea, assumes that the identity of a particular brand or company is compressed almost to the point of absurdity, but also more importantly to the point of exclusion of any other significance. It's a kind of reduction to the essence, and therefore the classical outcome of branding and fashion in America is a flagship store that is a kind of almost laughable accumulation of redundancy where everything is about this one thing. So what we thought would be good for Prada, that they had unstable stores that could have a different message in a different context, so the stores were also contextual, and that could have between them kind of different emanate and emit different values and different messages. So that it moved away from the certainty, but that these new stores were used on the contrary to create a climate of expectation and difference about Prada, rather than lead to a situation where expansion would inevitably to the loss of aura or quality. So just basically a strategy to maintain those qualities. So then, from a kind of very elaborate research phase, we moved into kind of actual design. And the first store that we did was the Guggenheim store in Soho, New York, on the site where there used to be the Guggenheim Museum. The Guggenheim Museum is shifting its design department to the ground floor, to the north, and Prada occupies the space formerly taken by the Guggenheim. Now, if you see this store, this plan of Soho, it's almost unbelievable that, and certainly one of the most devastating kind of evidences of the yes syndrome, that this 5 years ago was a cultural neighborhood with museums and galleries, and now literally every square foot of the ground floor is claimed by commercial activity, most of it fashion. So one thing that seemed promising is, and as a promising kind of try out for Prada to be different, was to introduce in this kind of relentless commercial climate an area of whiteness and of occasional non-commercialism. This is a diagram of the ground floor. The plan is complicated because it has a ground floor here and a basement that is actually in the next bay. So it was architecturally difficult to get people to the basement, so it's a weight movement in wood. And what we thought of in terms of how something could be both commercial or uncommercial was that all the display elements were on hanging on tracks in the space, and they could contract into a single kind of almost monumental sculpture, liberating the entire floor for other activities. And then this wave movement is used as an auditorium where the Guggenheim will organize its cultural activities. So in that sense, it's a store that offers a kind of alternation. Here you see the kind of movement, you see a part of the display elements shifted to the forward. Andreas Gursky, the German photographer, is contributing kind of one to the impermanence of the thing by having a selection or making special photographs that will be alternating and that will introduce thematic things independent of the fashion cycle. You see the hanging thing. It's a kind of city of these sculptures, the bursty, the connection to the other store. Use a Guggenheim auditorium, something rotates and makes a stage. And then underneath, or in the basement, there is a series of spaces that are based on strictly kind of rigorous elements, but that also, in an almost secretive way, are beginning to introduce some of the technologies. One thing that I find fascinating about the web is that certainly the estimations vary, but at least 50% of all activity is based on or an expression of interest in sex or sexuality. What we are trying to do is that the information that could be given in the stores on a technological level has this an almost sexual aura by hiding it in kind of different hidden parts, alcoves almost, and giving the scale of pornography. So that in that sense, the blatancy of most advertising is kind of reduced for kind of more secretive and private mode of consumption. We have worked on kind of reinventing the dressing room. Basically, if you take an item on the screen, kind of appear automatically all other kind of related items, potential choices, what is present in the store, and also other informations. And what is particularly kind of interesting is that we developed a dressing room where the mirror itself also shows your back, and where you can introduce a time delay so that it offers to address some of those intimate anxieties that is never systematically was shown. Here you see the dressing rooms. They have permalight glass so that if you want to be private, you can be private, but you can also show yourself to friends by making the window transparent. And here's then kind of finally a kind of triptych of web consumption, again, in the privacy. The second building is Los Angeles. I won't explain it in detail. It consists of three layers. It's low, it's on Rodeo Drive, and so the movement in New York that goes this way is reversed. There's an aluminum box that represents the main part of the store, men and women. The roof is also used as a lounge and as a kind of sports area, and this is almost conceived as a continuation of the street, and therefore a particular degree of openness. This is a kind of view over the through the middle. See the stairs, the aluminum box, and the top. What is interesting, because the Prada is sandwiched between Gucci and another kind of fashion, these fashion stores are becoming more and more like little modernist Art Deco fascist kind of mausoleums. So Prada is manifesting itself without text, without words, simply as a kind of concrete box. And at the end of the day, the box closes and leaves a gap. Aluminum box, and here, as opposed to all the other stores that have a kind of big view of the windows and the door, the windows are tunnels that look into the storage space and occasionally feature elements, and there is no facade. There's a kind of air curtain according to a new way, so that you basically, the street is incorporated in the whole thing. And the final building that I will show is a tower in San Francisco, and this is in itself an astonishing proof of the incredible power that fashion has, holds now, not only in terms of our imagination and our daily life and our daily desires, but also as economic power. They're building a building of 12 stories. They're almost all fashion. In the heart of San Francisco, on the corner of Grand Street and Market Street. And what we've conceived is a series of kind of very different open shapes that are excavated from an almost solid building. The skin of the building, and again, it is an outcome of intimate work with over archivist Cecil Belmont. Because it's San Francisco, it's an earthquake zone. Therefore, the skin of the building has to be structured, and it is a thick plate of stainless steel that is perforated in with irregular circles, so that it also performs as a truss. And through those holes, of course, you see some of the activity in the building. The ground floor is entirely given to the city, so that it's part of a strategy of generosity. It works because the shop window is appears like a diagonal element from the basement, and the roof of the shop window is used as a ramp or a staircase to get into the store. So basically, here you see the kind of situation. This is the display, a kind of army of Prada. People are ready to march on the city, and clients using the roof. So then you're there, first floor. I mentioned the word excavated. The spaces are excavated. In order to deal with the kind of essential unknowability of what the status of space is in general space, we started to talk about foam, or foam poche, or kind of cyber poche. What would be the equivalent of poche today? So since we work a lot in foam and styrofoam, the word foam came to mind. So we have been working very hard on developing a material that is neither solid nor air nor void, but that is kind of somewhere in between. And this is that material in its aluminum form, the core where you enter the building, bursty and fashioned. And then this is a typical case where two shapes, men and women, are exhibited from this new condition, and all the surfaces, elements, and excavator are embedded in this foam. And because the foam is porous, some of the light and some of the activities that are visible here will be made manifest on the outside. This is a view, and what it kind of will do, I think, is both exploit the lightness of most construction today and show also its fundamental ambiguity. That's what I'm taking you. What is very exciting in working for Pala is the interest of the company and of its authors in recontextualizing continuously fashion. So here we have proposed that in major space, sheet rock untreated, kind of only with the specs and in combination with their work, and that those kind of operations. In the middle of the building, there is a terrace and a espresso bar, and then the building continues with two half round spaces, and then the rest becomes office and penthouse. You're looking up at the terrace in two half round spaces, looking down on somebody who's standing on the glass roof on the terrace. And here you're in the two half rounds. And here the building. So it's astonishing experience is that in less than a year, because all of this started in I think in October of last year, in less than a year, we are obliged to develop not only the stores but also the interiors of the stores, and as I will show later, not only the technology in the stores, but as I will show later, we are taking it to some of the other identities of Prada too. Here an early kind of sample of the foam. It's a kind of silicone curtain display of the section of the hanging. We are very soon starting a similar research on how Prada should manifest itself on the web. Partly in a kind of primitive way, again, not the typical Helvetica. I mean, it's a major irony that the web, in spite of all its promiscuity, has become a haven for Helvetica, and so that is one of the things we want to break through. And finally, probably the architecture itself, which is becoming a campaign, as in these process. Now, it is of course an incredible pleasure to work on this kind of architecture and an architecture of this level of ambition and this level of sophistication also of the client. But nevertheless, I think it is important to see all this work as both intimately connected to the research in shopping and to some of what I think is a drastic effect on the status of architecture through its infinite, almost infinite engagement with shopping. The next project after shopping is a completely different project and has been a project on the city of Lagos. As I was working, and as we were working in on this level of increasingly rarefied economic possibilities, and increasingly working in a world which is clearly kind of dedicated to affluence and depending on affluence. I've found a corresponding interest in, not in poverty in itself, but in inventing or in thinking about the city, if the city is so pervasive and if it is ubiquitous, then also according to any most simplistic statistic, it means that the city will be, instead of an affluent phenomenon, predominantly become in the 21st century a phenomenon of poverty, and therefore to look at the connection between the city and poverty, and no city seemed more promising as a subject of investigation than Lagos, partly because it is a city that could be anywhere between 13 and 20 million people, but because of Nigeria's recent history, their history since its independence, a history of increasingly brutal kind of dictatorships, corruption, etc. Plus, it's still incredible potential as theoretically one of the richer African states, makes it a perfect example to work on trying to understand how Lagos works. This is the first iteration, Lagos Handbook. I don't think it will be the definitive title, but where we started to look in, you know, what Lagos actually is. And this was a kind of first, I've been there now three times, and what is compelling is how each visit completely suggests another reading of the city. This was my first reading of Lagos. Basically, it is a lagoon. The Atlantic Ocean is here. There is a number of islands here. This is a still recognizable as a kind of Western model of city, Lagos Island. This is an almost suburban luxury condition, Victoria Island. You see three bridges that go to the mainland. The mainland, at first sight, consisted mostly of chaos and rubbish dumps. This was a rubbish dump. An infernal intersection between all the traffic and an airport. So this is like Charles' drawing of that first Lagos. What is important is that there are a number of circles. There are 2 minute situations, 6 minute situations, and 12 minute situations. And that kind of simply suggested that in Lagos you sense that each condition and each moment has its own built-in time clock. And time is ticking, and in a 2 minute situation you have to be very careful and begin to evacuate it after 2 minutes, and then 6 minutes, etc. And also here are times written, and each of these times suggests the time according to which, according to urban myth, you should not use these connections anymore. So basically it would be suicidal after 21 o'clock to use this bridge, dangerous to use this one after 5, etc. And what was, of course, totally unclear is to what extent these myths were true or not true. But nevertheless, the combination of story, rumor, and observation was strongly suggesting that there is some truth to it. I think what is increasingly noticeable and part makes Lagos also part of the YES system, no matter how distantly, but there are very intimate connections, and in Lagos too everything turns about money, but because money was not never reprinted or revalued, it means that the smallest transaction in Lagos needs and implies the shift of a huge amount of physical money. Often very ancient and fungal, so that you kind of have the whole history of Nigeria of the past 30 years in your hands. In the beginning, I was kind of struck by first the images like this one, which show a river, and in the river there is, at first sight, it looks like a kind of fairly chaotic situation, but actually in the river are submerged a number of stones. Each stone is rented for 2 hour period to people who do laundry, 7 days a week. So underlying an image like this has got a very rigorous and stringent timetable. And not only that, but when you rent a stone, you also have right on an area kind of beyond in the landscape where you can dry the laundry. So again, what looks at first sight as a disorder is actually a highly organized condition. Similarly, what looked like the heart of Lagos, kind of crater of smoking garbage dump, was much more than that, because it was a kind of center where the contents of the dump were simply decomposed in their smallest part, so that that could be the beginning of a kind of recycling. What we now, after more intensive visits and more intensive preoccupation in the city, are we beginning to realize is that, for instance, there is an incredibly systematic and impressive system of markets that kind of maintains the city and that feeds the city, and that kind of simply organizes everything that is necessary for the city. This is the trajectory of one market that was kind of starting in the old Lagos, and that was electronics market, to its very size, simply expelled finally from a number of different locations to completely outside the city, where it is now the biggest market, electronic market in Western Africa. It has its own jail, two containers that have windows, and people are jailed if they counterfeit, because of course for an electronics market, fake is the most the strongest danger. But what is astonishing to discover, physically the market looks like a single crust of one-story garages. If you open the door of a garage, you're inundated by a glut of electronics, some of them second-hand, some of them old, some of them new. But what is incredible is that, in spite of its unprepossessing presence, each one of those markets has a 30-meter antenna to maintain the kind of mobile phone system of the owners. So physically, it's unimpressive, but technologically, it's an incredible forest. What is also unbelievable is that this market alone, and this is the diagram, has in permanence 24 scouts traveling around the world that buy, that first do research and then buy where it is cheapest, an endless number of supplies in America, in Korea, in Taiwan, in Singapore, in India. And these are the kind of relative sizes. So Singapore is a kind of very important country for them. Dubai, in Russia, a lot of old electronics in Russia. All of it, and in different African states, all of it orchestrating the largest importation of electronics in the whole of Africa. So a single market is the largest importer. What we began increasingly aware of is that the first site of Lagos, which is kind of incredible human crowds and incredible traffic congestion and incredible, almost tortured urban realm, is in fact not a continuous urban realm, but is basically a kind of series of fault lines that are kind of running between more composed and more integrated elements, almost enclaves, almost cities in themselves, and that basically the major economic activity occurs on through the kind of webbing of those interfaces, and that on those conditions you get an incredible density, but not only the density that looks at first at grotesque. This is a market that is combined with a railway track, so that when the train appears like a Red Sea, the market kind of opens, but actually the train goes so slowly that the sectioning, the cutting of the market is also kind of an economic opportunity for stock material to need to be sold to the train. And the scale of these things is literally unbelievable. We were lucky in kind of finally obtaining the right to travel over Lagos by helicopter. And then you see images like this one, which are really, I think, astonishing. You have to kind of fly over. traffic jams, these are traffic jams. This is the trajectory of the railway line, but every spare millimeter is used also for human activity and for small economic attractions. And in the same kind of generous movement, you see how yellow is the public transport, kind of presses itself to the system. But the important thing is to realize that it's not an aberration, but actually a system for interchange and transaction. So here, you know, from the whole thing from a big distance, one of those nodes, the traffic jam that is kind of much more than a jam, but actually an opportunity for exchange. The huge crowds, this is where the railway is. And basically a series of close-ups of the track. Red can be either meat, tomatoes, or peppers. The railway track, and now you see it all over the space of 200 meters, the kind of activity diminishing and petering out, and resuming a kind of more recognizable ashes of burned debris. What is also very inspiring and at the same time shocking to realize is that Lagos, with its independence in the 60s, became, of course, kind of a very attractive subject for speculation, for architectural thinking and architectural thinkers. And as you see here in a kind of sketch Doxiadis made in 1970, where he speculated about the future of the world metropolis, black is the universal city. Gray is other habitable areas, and white is thinly populated, and you see that here in Nigeria, there is a considerable part of black, and the black also is part of Lagos. Lagos is. So, Lagos was not always an invisible city, and on the contrary, it became in the 60s and 70s the subject of a number of Western speculations, but also interventions, and ironically interventions that left very large and very still completely intact traces. So it's a city on the one hand completely African and kind of extreme as I showed, but also one that has huge housing complexes, apartment blocks, infrastructure. Not only Doxiadis, who you see here, but also Otto Koningsberger, a famous AA teacher when I was there, who was also responsible for the design of Singapore, played a major role, and Maxwell Fry, after Schellinger, also came to Lagos to help to organize the city. What is interesting, we discovered in the Doxiadis archives a whole series of diagrams that at first sight look utterly frivolous, but that on closer inspection are actually fairly perceptive. Perceptive in terms of recognizing or conceiving the city in terms of major entities and kind of flow spaces around them that where those kind of frictions occur. I've no time to kind of really explain them. But I will show one of these kind of elements and one of those kind of sequences of you know, historical accident, I think, that is in itself a miniature story of what you can discover in Lagos. This is the mainland bridge arrives here on Lagos Island. You see it's a kind of very classical kind of cloverleaf intersection designed by architects and planners, and excavated, scraped from a kind of much denser area. It lands here, and you see here that kind of a large part where it's scraped kind of from an otherwise strange mixture of Western architecture and kind of African architecture, which is Lagos Island. When I went there a year ago, it was a swamp, and it was one of the most notorious places in the city in terms of crime, because a bridge dead ends there. The car, the driver is kind of propelled in a labyrinth, anyone can kind of simply stop and abort any movement, and then you end in a kind of morass of crime or other. Here you see a kind of image of it at the time, a crust of crime or a crust of debris, agriculture, goats, cows, and behind it almost kind of marooned in time the city of Lagos with large percentage of the building of its skyscrapers abandoned. Here you see a further image. But what I came back 6 weeks ago and discovered that that kind of same area being completely transformed, but again what looked at first sight like a dump, was showing kind of signs of organization. You see that under the viaduct there is some kind of activity, and somehow the dump is refined into, it's emptied. Actually, there is a lot of kind of sorting going on, and what is being kind of produced from the debris is kind of new containers that can then become part of the kind of productive process. So a space like this is actually a factory, and we analyze here in this one how the different parts and bays are kind of used and what activities are sequential, so that it's kind of wheel cart, kerosene burners. So here you see both, these are kind of almost like ateliers, so small studio workshops that are producing elements like here, that are also selecting the materials so that electronics in themselves form new potential amalgamation. Microsoft is now hiring Nigerian programmers because of their unequal ability to match unequal systems, and you can see where it comes from. And it is not certainly not difficult to imagine how what first sight looks like a crust can actually become kind of with minimal intervention in technology and minimal intervention in communication, suddenly take off like a brush fire. And so only 9 or 10 months after my first visit, where this was the most notorious part of the city, it is now increasingly ordered. You can actually go there. And this was the image I took of the same place that the first was a swamp. Now a kind of completely ordered landscape with the city. So I think that maybe one of the interesting consequences of poverty is that the rate of change can be even faster than it is here. And that therefore we are probably can probably expect a sequence of incredibly radical phase differences, where something that is kind of utterly poor in 1 or 2 years can move to the other side. Basically, I want to end the lecture now. For Nigeria, you need a lot of injections, inoculations for medical reasons. I think you need 12, and in my case, 2 years ago, the 12th one went wrong, and I developed meningitis. That was an interesting experience, which for me there's a kind of analogy between the kind of pattern and even the shape there. So it was a kind of probably a kind of anticipatory sympathy, and it was a kind of radical interruption, and as such an important part of a kind of almost unconscious reorientation, if only because it was out of action, kind of really from architecture for a month. There are other signs, without wanting to kind of inflate their importance, the WTO thing in Seattle could be, and according to certain experts, is the beginning of a kind of more aggressive form of malaise with the current economic system and its brutality. At the same time, there was a kind of a recent ceremony in Jerusalem, which in itself was kind of highly connected to my introduction, the way in which architecture is still completely imprisoned in a mythology of and a value system of solidity and solidity and matter. Of all places in the world, it was organized on one of the most contested, the Temple Mountain in Jerusalem. That meant that the ceremony had to be guarded by a kind of ring of soldiers, and that I was put, whether I wanted to or not, in a kind of semi-political situation. It meant for me a kind of a moment of infinite embarrassment, because I think that the current discourse of architecture is so completely unpolitical that I think it was not bad intentions of the committee, but simply the innocent assumption that there could be no longer a connection between architecture and politics, and that you can now organize any event for architecture anywhere, because no architect will ever feel offended or surprised by its location. And in the lecture, in the thank you note, I had to say that political innocence is assumed to be one of the most important properties of the contemporary, useful tools of the contemporary architect. What also seemed appalling is that I was supposedly the winner because of my affinity with the future, but it was given here in a kind of site where the stones, the youngest stone was probably more than 5,000 years old, and it was also an almost laughable commitment to matter. As you see here, this wall is a kind of colossal wall. It must be one of the biggest pile of matter ever assembled in the history of mankind. Herodotus, the palace of Herodotus, a sacred place for the Jews, the Christians, and Islamic religion, and basically, I was giving a speech about the way in which architecture already has been liberated and unbeknown to us, and that we can, if we want to, cut our sever our ties to substance. it was a kind of bizarre point to make that. It was a political situation. The first speaker introduced at the last moment was the mayor of Jerusalem, a hardcore defender of unification. And in order to show my reservation, I had gone on a kind of tour of the West Bank with an Arab guide to see the situation, the other side of the kind of equation there. So this is the West Bank. And very painful that those things could be connected in such a short accommodation. So that is another, that was another ingredient of the whole situation. Altogether, the accumulation of these experiences have made it important for us to reconsider how architecture is done and what an office is. And we are therefore engaged in a number of kind of experimental enterprises. One of them is a collaboration with Herzog & Dumeron on a project in New York. And what the intention is, eventually, and that is not yet taking place in this project, is that we can merge our delivery systems, to use a terrible American word. In other words, we can share our technical abilities, the way we make things, into a kind of single office. And there is a third, potential third American partner who is also willing to contribute to this whole entity. And it's not Skidmore, but also a very creative American office. And what that would mean is not a kind of grab for larger power, but it would mean that simply architects like them, like ourselves, like him, have never really, are always facing a condition that there is a certain kind of project that we would simply never get. We would get cultural projects, we would get refined projects, we would get all the kind of peripheral projects, but some serious issues like a major office building in New York or a major or a normal university would always disappear. So it is kind of basically to reconstitute ourselves on one end, to share much more information and to abandon the kind of, isolation in which most architecture is taking place, which enables, of course, anyone of us to be played against every one of, all of us, but therefore form a consolidation also of the technique. This is an image of New York. It will not be like this, but simply as a kind of emblem. And the final and more radical, maybe, idea is that we will simply, the sequence of events of the past 2 years has now inspired a kind of cell division, maybe, that there is a field of architectural thinking and of architectural intervention. Only part of it is connected to mud or stone or all the kind of concrete elements that we all know. There, OMA will remain active and we will share creative work with of our, also with Guzmao. But we also start a kind of mirror image, AMO. It's a, it can be anything. There will be no explanation what the letters mean. And basically, AMO is for all the kind of thinking that is architectural without any need for architectural expression or embodiment in architecture. It is very ironic that, and a little bit sad, that architecture as a metaphor is becoming more and more dominant in our culture. You cannot talk to a computer programmer or a factory without people saying the architecture of this, the architecture of that, the architecture. But that we, because we are still so marooned in a completely old way of defining ourselves, are the last to benefit from what is an incredible interest in our thought processes and a need for kind of similar thought processes that are not applied to building, but that are applied to organizations and more pure conceptual models. And as an inevitable part of that, Harvard will also create the fuel for that kind of research. So what it enables is also to, for instance, maybe consider at some moment that we will start making movies again. Perhaps a Lagos movie could be interesting. And that we also have associations with, for instance, McKinsey in certain organizational models. So basically, what it enables us to do is and kind of fluid and flowing kind of activity that can take place anywhere along these kind of borders, and that also in terms of workforce creates a kind of incredible interchangeability between all these components, and therefore a much more alert reaction to potential. That's it. There's only one more thing, and that is kind of basically an announcement. 2 years, 4 weeks ago, I was in Russia for the first time in 30 years. It was almost part of a kind of similar experience as Lagos, in the sense that it was completely astonishing 30 years later to be in the territory of former communism, to see public space very little changed since the era of communism, but also to see entire cities that were like Leningrad was and St. Petersburg still is, articulated on kind of ideal models of equality, brotherhood, etc., etc. And it, I must say, it was a kind of very strong shock to see how far we had kind of evolved toward assuming the kind of absurdity of all those teams and their strengths, particularly intersecting the current situation. So the announcement is simply that probably the next 2 years of the Harvard project will be dedicated to the to communism. Thank you. Thank you.
Maybe there's time for a few questions. I could possibly start by, one of the most probably an obvious question is that given your research in Lagos and placing that in the context of the earlier investigations in Southeast Asia, somehow now this discussion of the issue of the political and your reference to that or your interest in that, how do you see the political in a way negotiating this line of play between the virtual and actual in your schema of future operations? What role will the political play between the virtual and the actual?
Well, to the extent that the virtual is everything which is not I think it will be play a bigger role in the virtual than in the actual. I think that the interesting thing to discover is that there is, and that may be a byproduct of our wallowing in a kind of formal mythology. It also means that in most actual building operations, there is still a political dimension, or perhaps not in the case of the Prada stores, but certainly in the case of the library or in the case of the concert hall that we're in the their operations for the public good. But at the same time, the paradox is that that aspect of it has been completely denied in a way by the current way in which architecture manifests itself. It's sheer evasion of the political issue. And I think that through the Harvard project, for instance, we will be able to eventually develop a kind of really something more akin to a kind of critique, but maybe also more likely to inspire what could be maybe a kind of redefinition of certain political presence or a kind of renewal of certain political presence. And clearly we're not alone, and clearly you can see the signs everywhere that after a kind of exhilarating suspension of the question of politics that in itself was maybe necessary to create a kind of almost laboratory condition for investigation, it's coming back from all sides.
But the degree to which a lot of the research has focused this concept of the lack of control, for example, that happens in certain situations and the celebration of those things, like in Southeast Asia, or in terms of...
I
in
think
terms of
basically our activity has been kind of really understood, maybe as a celebration, but when the books come out, I think it will be very clear that it's not a celebration. And one of the interesting parts of the China book, for instance, is the fact that underlying the entire phenomenon is a very strong control of the Communist Party. And therefore, I think the China experiment is not a kind of free-for-all at all, but it is a kind of deliberate campaign, maybe in the same tradition of drastic course revisions that Chinese always imposed on the population to destabilize them and to always gain the upper hand. And we have a chapter called Infrared, which really tries to describe the way in which among kind of apparently Western and capitalist ideas, there's always the control of the Communist Party kind of that is asserting itself. And I think that what is ironic is that the advocates of the market economy, you know, have always been the first, of course, to embrace China as kind of finally seeing the light. And I think the Chinese have exploited that embrace without really sacrificing much of their control.
Maybe there's a question there.
Yeah, I was interested.
Yeah, speak to it. They'll turn the volume.
Yeah. I was interested in your distinction between the virtual and the actual. Hani Rashid, who's doing a lot of virtual work and the virtual Guggenheim and so on, refers to his work on the computer as a second-order reality. And it seems to me, certainly in terms of shopping, that the possibilities of dot-com sort of design going onto the web and so on is a hugely important area. Does that play a factor in your approach towards sort of shopping? And do you see virtual reality as a potential realm of actual architecture?
Now, I think that for the past 5 years, we had a kind of complicated relationships with the virtual, because the virtual in architecture was usually used to create computer simulations for what eventually would be an architecture. And I always felt really uncomfortable in the kind of reactionary use of the medium, and to see forms that had thickness, shadow, and almost a hyper-realism, and that increased substitute reality for, and so therefore the word virtual, the word reality is not part of my definition of the virtual. But at the same time, of course, I think that in that period, incredible architectural things have been invented and thought out, and so I think it's sort of kind of a really beautiful moment. But somehow we never, as an office, could find it in us to endorse it. And I think it's really only now that by put it clearly, leave it up to reality and embracing as the virtual anything that is not built, so therefore pure thinking, pure organization, pure strategies, pure, for me it has become a kind of more clear domain.
It's interesting the interaction between your research and your design in the way, like a lot of architects, there's disjunctions between the one and the other, and then one goes ahead of the other so far, and then the other thing catches up. So in a way, and ironically, I suppose, shopping is caught up with the shopping book. But your thought is even ahead, maybe, of your what you can do. So you're thinking now economically and politically, which you weren't doing when we last discussed this, when you were writing the book on shopping. And I said, why don't you, at Harvard, since Harvard is surrounded by economists and globalizing thinkers, why don't you have one person, or several people, or team, which actually engages globalization and economics on a theoretical level? Because it's still, however impressive what you're doing and showing is, and however much you are moving into economics, now even politics, at least fleeting politics, because you don't stay around to get shot. I just wonder, when will you get, would you, gets it. You know, the thing is, Jane Jacobs moved in exactly this trajectory with similar conclusions. I know you'll like that. So when will you get
I'm going to take the microphone.
When will you get into economics, have an economics
turn the volume down.
In every project, as you will also discover, there is a kind of strong economic component already. But I think that on the other hand, I don't think that anyone is helped by, if I would a kind of more serious, or would become an economist. I mean, I really don't see what the advantage would be. I think there's so many economists, we can kind of incorporate so many economists in our activities or in our work that maybe it will happen. I mean, I'm not saying it's excluded, but I'm not seeing also kind of very compelling reasons. right now. But what by would you what
okay,
what
can I take the microphone? Huh?
If we tie a lot of the threads which remain together, you can actually
address. Yeah, but I'm less interested. I'm less interested in you are in tying threads together, and I think that in a way I think that to live with the looseness of the different ends represent maybe you're a theoretician, but I'm not a theoretician. So I think that for me the loose ends represents the potential to continue or to reconnect.
We're going to write this one down. You're not a theoretician.
Okay, go
ahead. Ian, sorry.
How would you exercise your judgment as a political judgment as an architect in the corporate world? I mean, in the purely political world, it's fairly straightforward. There are governments and states that want an architect to build buildings to glorify the political system. It's fairly easy to pick and choose. You wouldn't want to glorify a faction state. But more it's now corporations that want their image glorified. How do you pick and choose there? I mean, is it the products? Is it the image of the corporation?
Your question doesn't take into account that you never pick and choose. but that is very important. I've always been very frank about the essentially passive nature that architecture inherently implies vis-a-vis that kind of context. I think all you can do is say no. And the chance specifically that the wrong corporation would pick you, the wrong corporation being, for instance, arms manufacturer, are very slight. So in that sense, there's a kind of, you emanate something, some interest, burst of interest, and, you know, on the whole, the architecture system works to the extent that people
that they embrace you when there's affinity anyway, but which is not a very courageous statement. But, I mean, so far that kind of courage hasn't been necessary, and I am not. I would have to improvise the moment that happened.
I have a question to the Prada. To come back, I would like to see an answer for the urban dimension of the Prada. How you see the landscape changing? That it seemed to be that the kind of the traditional public space we're longing for are now given us by this kind of fashion institution. So what do you think is the urban dimension of your proposal?
What do you mean by the traditional urban space we're longing for?
It seemed to me that
Are you longing for it? because I mean, that's exactly what makes me so allergic about the kind of profession of architecture. The kind of unquestioned assertions that urban space or public space is good. I think that we, and for me, that is the interesting thing about China, that urban space is no longer urban space. It's no longer kind of fully formed, defined, architecturally defined condition. Urban space is now a territory in which events can unfold. And I think that that is really a key shift, but unfortunately, I also think that architecture is still deeply, you know, engaged with creating urban space, and to the extent that there is maybe a latent criticism, it becomes very difficult to develop an architecture, even for Prada, that avoids entirely that terminology or even that manifestation.
I'm interested to know how the design of information systems inside buildings, in reference to the library, would affect political hierarchies of the organisation themselves, and how that's affected how you work.
Well, I think maybe next year I should give a lecture about those kind of experiences, because first of all they're kind of ongoing and kind of fairly early. And I don't have a good answer at this point.
Or even how you think the arrival of the internet has shaped how people think about or how it affects physical design of physical space?
I think that there's kind of probably one connection that I see, that which is the almost compulsive drama and theatricality of public space and of space kind of in general, as a kind of counter to the assumed glamour or attraction of the internet. So it seems as if there is almost a paroxysm, a kind of retreat to the last and final qualities that architecture had, which is to impress, to be dramatic, to be insane, in order to safeguard at least some territory safe, or to actually create one experience that the internet will forever be unable to deliver. And I think that kind of tension and polarity is currently, for me, one of the, you know, continuous almost Chinese water tortures that is being kind of dripping on architecture's head.
But in the case of the Seattle Library, there are a lot of decisions, presumably, that have to do with your rethinking of the organizational structure of the library and the use of certain computer systems, yeah, so on and so forth. But there comes also a moment where you are making very clear formal decisions, right, in terms of the shape of the library, it's the projections, the deformations of the form itself. So how do you reconcile these organizational structures with very clear formal aesthetic decisions that must obviously be an important part of the project? How do you make those decisions?
I think that my answer would be, there's one way out, which is kind of formlessness, or let's say the Gehry way, which I really admire, and particularly in Seattle, he's done an incredible building with Jimi Hendrix experience, which I think is much more interesting than the Guggenheim, because it has no recognizable element of a building, it has no entrance, no nothing. But I think that for me, the analogy or the viability of the diagram in either a virtual space or real space, and the way in which they could perform the same task in both, what is an interesting test in Seattle.
Could you pass the microphone right at the back?
I have a question about how the staff would interact and the personnel between Herzog and Demiron and yourself. Like, is that personal or is that through media? How would you pull that off?
We've been working together now for 3 months. I'll give you the kind of straight story. And it works that either I go to Basel for a day or 2 days, or they, that is usually Pierre, Herzog, and Harry, come to us. And then we both have two people in our offices working on the project, and increasingly they are always together, so whether it's in Basel or in there. And what has been for me the most interesting thing is that it's not only the work on the project, because that is incredible to see and to, let's say, reveal, because it obviously occurring at the moment of maximum nakedness in any architecture project, you know, we show our own nakedness and they show their nakedness. But it's really the ability it gives to perceive how an organization is structured and how the creative process is structured, where the kind of priorities are, and vice versa. And so it's for us, again, almost a form of research in terms of how a combination could be very strong, but also how, you know, we could change in a certain way, and presumably how they can change in a certain way. So, but one of the things we could we've both been endlessly hesitant about websites. So one thing is that we explore that terrain together. And it's also very important to say it's not an exclusive connection. I mean, it can be kind of really part of a more kind of distributed form of architectural intelligence. I think also that one important part of it is that it is also a collaboration between two medium cities that have very few recognizable attractions, and that therefore are kind of have a kind of basic and that are not part of a scene. I think, strangely enough, it would be really hard to do that between London and New York.
How do you see your position as a guiding person in architecture when you use materials like in the Prada shops that are very kind of on the corner of sustainable, or that you, let's say, we're kind of running out of resources and everything, and you use many, many materials like aluminium and things that are kind of unsustainable?
We're not against sustainable architecture, but we are not for it either. I think that
after politics comes up sustainability.
I think that we, let's say, our last four buildings are very serious about the economy of systems. So I think the discussion about individual materials is for me somewhat marginal, but the discussion of technical systems, how they run, what kind of economies they can introduce, and how much of energy can be maintained is very serious. So
you would see this as an exception?
Not entirely an exception, but as yet an explored terrain.
Rem, thank you. Congratulations on the Pritzker. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.